Professor, thank you for joining us. I very much enjoyed your presentation. Now, in the presentation, you touched on the fear of Islam in the West, and specifically fear by Australians of Indonesian Islam. Can you expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, I think in the last decade, I think, let's say after September 11, or also after Bali bombing in Indonesia, most discussion on Indonesian Islam center on radicalism and intolerance among Muslims. While of course this kind of radicalism and intolerance is basically a small fraction of Indonesian Islam as a whole, they tend to forget the other aspect of Indonesian Islam, that is Sufism. Sufism is very strong in Indonesia up until now, and then Sufism is basically enrich religious experience in among Indonesian Muslim, because Indonesian Muslims love to practice what I call as a colorful and flowery Islams, rather than dry primitive Islam as introduced as preached by the Salafis or Wahhabis. That's why the Wahhabis and Salafis failed to influence, to spread, their Salafism in the country. In fact, the term Wahhabism is anathema, is very pejorative among Indonesian Muslim. So that's why with the rise of Muslim middle class and Islamic spirituality, Sufism, is again gaining momentum in the country, and then take various kind of expressions.
So one of the issues, I think, is that Islam is often seen as being homogenized or monolithic, but it's rich in diversity. Can you expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, of course, Islam is not monolithic. Yeah, it's not monolithic. If you compare, let's say, Indonesian Islam with, let's say, Arabian Islam, of course, there are many differences. There's a lot of differences among them. I think this is also because of sociology of Muslim societies in Indonesia, which is different. For instance, in Indonesia, Muslim women occupies a very important position. They are not segregated. They are not segregated from public life. For instance, in Indonesia, women are allowed. It is customary for Muslim women to read Quran in public. There are competition of Quranic recitation in Indonesia where women join the competition, but that's not the case in most Muslim countries elsewhere. Women are not allowed to recite Quran in public. Women are not allowed to lead the celebration of the Prophet's birthday, for instance. But it is common in Indonesia that women lead the celebration of the Prophet birthday by reciting salawat. Salawat is the praise to the Prophet Muhammad. So women also pray in the mosque. One day I actually accompanied Prince Charles when he visited Jakarta to the Istiqlal Mosque, the largest mosque in Indonesia, not to say in Southeast Asia. He was very surprised to find that Muslim women are walking around in the main hall of the mosque. How come? Because he said in his country, in England, women are not allowed to enter the main hall of the mosque. So I said, this is, the Indonesian Islam that is very friendly to Muslim women. Women are allowed to have their bank accounts, they are allowed to drive herself. That's not the case in many, Arab countries, particularly in Saudi Arabia and also in the Gulf countries. So these are some of the distinction of Indonesian Islam that give a very positive and also positive role to women.
In the title of your speech, you use the words Sufism and secular state. Can you explain why you brought those two terms together and how Indonesia can act as a model for Islamic states?
Yeah, in Indonesia, despite the fact that almost 90% of Indonesia's total population is Muslim, Indonesia is not an Islamic state, nor is Islam is the official religion of the state. Islam, in fact, Indonesia is a secular state, meaning religion is not basis of the state. Indonesia is based on Pancasila, the five principles, in which the first principle is belief in one supreme God. So, even though Indonesia is a secular state, but the ideology of Pancasila, the five pillar, is friendly to religion, because the very first pillar of Pancasila, of the five principles, is belief in one supreme God. So that's why Pancasila is indeed acceptable for virtually all Muslim group, except some of them, small numbers, or small group of Muslim who want to transform Indonesia into Islamic state. But of course, they fail to transform Indonesia into an Islamic state, because Muslim in general, represented by organizations like Nahdlatul Ulama and Muhammadiyah, oppose the creation of Islamic state in Indonesia, because for them, Indonesia as Pancasila state is already Islamic enough. Yeah? And then also Pancasila can be accepted by non-Muslim Indonesia. So, Pancasila is in fact the unifying factor, unifying ideology for different groups, not only among Muslim, but also among Muslim and non-Muslim in the country.
A theme that's developed in the last 2 days of the conference has been the changing nature of globalization and the rise of the influence of Asia. And this has been portrayed in a rising confidence in some nations such as Singapore and Malaysia. Do you see similar things happening in Indonesia, and do you feel a sense of optimism?
Yeah, I feel some kind of optimism, particularly with the economic situation, which is very good in Indonesia. Annually, we can reach something like 6.5 economic growth. And then, of course, with the improvement of the economy, and then we will be able to address problems like poverty and also unemployment. And then also at the same time, of course, we are able to increase the number of middle class Indonesia who are backbone of many social programs in the country, because Indonesian state actually does not is not able to address all social problems, social and economic problems. So we are very fortunate in Indonesia to have many non-government organizations, many religious-based organizations that play a very important role, not only in providing social services, providing good education, but also at the same time play a very important role as civil society, providing or developing, strengthening civic culture among population. And of course, civic culture is very important in order to strengthen civility, and civility is very important for democracy to work, because again, Indonesia is with the largest Muslim population. I think it's a good showcase for the compatibility between Islam and democracy. In Indonesia, of course, there is no problem between Islam and democracy, like what we have now in many Arab countries during transition after Arab Spring since last year, I think. So we need, at the same time, we need to address problems in Indonesia, like corruption, lack of law enforcement. I think these are some of the problems that we have to to resolve in the next few years in order for us to be able to have a real democracy where law and order is upheld by all people.